Year 11s, we're now going to be looking at chapter 4.8, which is our last chapter, so this is our last video for this semester. Humans have engineered the environment for thousands of years, but the rate of change has accelerated in the last 100 years. Now, there's a huge number of different ways we can look at this. Perhaps the easiest is we can just look at a population diagram over the last 100 years or so. And it's just been an explosion in the human population. And this has had a huge impact on the environment. Obviously, all of these new people need somewhere to live. And this rate of change, this expansion of our human population, is apparently accelerating. In the developed world, our populations are actually decreasing, but it's the developing world that is causing the most amount of change in terms of our population. And this change has coincided with a massively accelerated rate of extinction. Now, if we look at some statistics from a few years ago, so there was a bit of research that was done in the late 2000s that found that the rate of extinction was happening approximately a million times faster than it has in any other time in history, even before with human environments or with human impact on environment. It is now happening a million times faster than it ever has before. Now, although there are a lot of different human behaviors that have contributed to these problems, there are four that stand out as the most catastrophic. And they are habitat fragmentation, the enhanced greenhouse effect, and there's an important differentiation there, introduced species, and agricultural practices, how we actually go about farming. So we'll look at each of those in turn. Firstly, habitat fragmentation. Ecosystems, we routinely degrade them by human behaviors. One of the biggest ones is by harvesting and clearing of land for agriculture, for timber, for mining, for cities, as we'll see in an example in the moment. Habitat fragmentation occurs when an ecosystem is split into smaller sections. Each of those sections is going to have inadequate resources to sustain their communities. This might be because certain resources are only available in one area, or it might be that the area is just too small to support the species that are there, and so that population is going to reduce. Potentially, the population diversity might drop as well. And as we saw in previous videos, that loss of population is going to lead to a snowballing effect on the rest of the communities. Reducing habitat also increases the overlap of certain niches, and this increases new pressures, new selection, and this further increases the risk of extinction for certain species. Now, we can think about an Australian example that's really important for this, where we're looking at certain species of birds, especially small birds, which require a certain amount of space. The contraction of their habitat has meant that they're now interacting more frequently with more aggressive bird species. So your galahs, rosellas, crows, larger bird populations that are able to bully these smaller birds out of their ordinary habitat. In the past, when there was enough space, there was less interaction, but there's been more significant overlap of these niches, and because of the aggression of these other bird species, they're actually having a significant selective advantage, and these quieter or more docile bird species are actually reducing their population. So if we just quickly look at the board now, I just want to show you an example of exactly what habitat fragmentation looks like. So here we've just got a city which is just popped in the middle of park number one, park number two, and park number three. Now, traditionally what would have been before the city is that this would have all been one giant ecosystem altogether, but now they're considerably three smaller ecosystems, and neither of these ecosystems possess enough resources to support each of their populations. And so there's a significant problem. What's going to happen? Well, we're either going to get niche overlap, which is going to increase the pressure, decrease population sizes, potentially cause extinction for some species. Otherwise, we're just going to get perhaps a keystone species lost. And this is going to have a massive impact, as we talked about in the last few videos. So we have to be so careful with how we break up habitat. And in our local area, one of the classic examples of that is Golden Grove. This was previously, as the name would sort of suggest, this was a grove that existed, that it had beautiful trees and existing native habitat, and a lot of that's been cleared for human development for this city that is Golden Grove. Now, that's obviously beneficial for humans, but it has had a significant impact on other species populations. All right, so back to the slides. So what we're looking at here with habitat fragmentation, onto the next slide here. So with the enhanced greenhouse effect, the invention of the internal combustion engine is really, and the wholesale burning of fossil fuels, the massive burning of fossil fuels, has led to a massive increase in greenhouse gas emissions. This has been compounded by the developed world's desire for meat, particularly from ruminants like sheep and cattle. A ruminant is a type of animal that ruminates on its food. It's got a particular structure in its stomach which allows it to break down grasses. But on the flip side to that, these animals release large volumes of methane, which is another very powerful greenhouse gas. So we have this dual problem where we have increasing CO2 levels. We have increasing methane gas levels, which are going, both of these are greenhouse gases. So we have this enhanced greenhouse effect where the Earth is supposed to be kept warm, but these emissions of these two greenhouse gases particularly are increasing that temperature beyond what is normal. The increasing CO2 levels have another impact, which is that they end up being dissolved into the oceans, and this increases the acidity of the oceans, which has led to bleaching of corals. Recently, we've also observed rising sea levels, which is thought to have been caused by melting ice at the poles of the Earth because of the increasing temperatures caused by the greenhouse effect. Now, again, we have these changes. So we think, well, how are these changes? How are these alterations in the ecosystem? How are they actually impacting organisms? Well, let's just focus on the rising sea levels. If you've got a low-lying island, Australia isn't a good example because around our coast we generally have hills and mountains, but if we have a low-lying island like a lot of the Pacific islands, where they're at sea level or in some cases below sea level, as the sea rises, they're going to become flooded. And quite recently, I think it was in some of the Micronesian islands, we've actually had certain non-profit groups, certain non-government organizations actually buy land so that people can, refugees, environmental refugees, can actually have somewhere to live because their homes are being flooded by these rising sea levels. Now that's happening now. And we predict that this melting of the ice caps is going to accelerate. So that's how it's affecting humans. It's going to be affecting animals in a very similar way, except we don't have the advantage, animals don't have the advantage of hopping into boats and going off somewhere else. They've got to hope that a bird picks the insect up and carries it away, or for a plant that something picks it up and swims away with it or flies away with it and plants it somewhere else. So these are big, big problems. We're looking at indicator species as well. So although we've kind of gone through the doom and gloom of the situation, there is also a bit of a silver lining to all of this. It has driven a lot of scientific investigation and discovery. And one of those is that certain organisms can act as a kind of early warning sign, where we can actually get an idea of what's about to happen before it actually happens. One of the ways that this is done is by using algal populations. Waterways are continuously monitored for a process called eutrophication, which is basically where algae populations explode in massive numbers because of excess nutrients, typically due to runoff from fertilizers. The algal blooms will block sunlight, and because they don't have any sun, the plants will die because they can't go through photosynthesis. The dead plants are then broken down by bacteria, which uses oxygen, and this leads to the loss of other populations as they effectively drown in the water that normally keeps them alive. These dead organisms are then further decomposed, which uses up more oxygen. So the oxygen required in an ecosystem, we call it the biochemical oxygen demand, or BOD. And this is continuously monitored by authorities so that owners and government groups are able to respond to the ecosystem's change before it actually becomes a large problem. So the impact of these algal populations has led to us understanding what's going on. So we monitor the biological oxygen demand, or biochemical oxygen demand, so that we can actually make sure that we deal with the problem before it's actually a big issue. So there are some advantages to this. Where we're looking now at, rather than just a localized solution to the problem, we can now look at a more global strategy to reduce human impact. One of the big ones, and this will be one of our last few slides, I'll go back to the board in a moment just so I can talk about another strategy, but a lot of countries recognize that we've had a big impact on the environment. And so in 2015, they gathered together to sign the Paris Agreement. This was basically an agreement where a number of different strategies and caps that were suggested by scientists were adopted, which means that these countries, or the leaders of the country, said, yes, we sign up to this, we will try and achieve these. One of them was a cap of 2 degrees Celsius from pre-industrial temperatures. Now, we're already slightly above, that should say above, not about, sorry, but slightly above 1 degree Celsius. So they're basically saying that we are going to make sure that temperatures don't increase above 2 degrees Celsius from the 1900s. Unfortunately, because of significant political instability in one of the large or one of the most important populations in the world, or countries in the world, large corporations, green lobby groups, they're increasingly taking the lead on these issues while encouraging individuals to make changes themselves. If we look at Australia as an example, AGL, which is a power company, they've got a huge campaign at the moment where they're talking about how they're going to shut down all coal-fired power stations. They're shifting towards renewable energies. The government doesn't like that, and we won't get into that. But they are themselves taking it upon themselves to say, look at what we're doing. It's an advertising campaign. They're trying to get people in. But they're saying, look at what we're planning to do to deal with this problem. And effectively, they're doing that because the government are incapable of doing it themselves, because they're more concerned about who is getting voted in and all of those sorts of things. And it's left to these large businesses and green lobby groups to take leadership on this. Now, as I said, just want to jump to this board again, just so I can talk a little bit about another strategy that's being employed. Here is our fragmentation diagram again. I haven't changed anything just yet. One of the things that we've discovered is that we can set up these things called wildlife or habitat corridors, which are where when we have fragmented an ecosystem, we can actually rejoin them simply by making a narrow strip of connecting red vegetation. So from here, I'll use red just so it's clearly different. We just create a little pathway which connects the parts. And this allows animals to move so that as resources get exhausted in park one, they can move over to park three. And then as resources aren't present in park two, but are present in park one, those animals or those plants can then be moved over there by whatever means they require. So this is a really, really critical situation that we've got, and a really clever strategy to solving a problem. We can't move the city, but we can adapt our behavior to actually increase the likelihood or decrease the impact of our behaviors, increase the likelihood of survival or decrease the impact of our behaviors. All right, last two slides. So there's a discussion now on farming and sustainability that I want you to go through, and you just follow the instructions. This is one where it's focused or it's based on something from your textbook. So go there and open up the textbook, follow the instructions. This will be one that you'll need to do a Word document for and copy and paste it over or something, because it's a bit more extensive. We also have another activity. Now I'm going to ask you to hold off on this for a little while. We're going to complete this game in class, and you may need to remind me if I do in fact forget this. But this brings us basically to the end of our discussions here. We've got some key terms and questions, page 421 and chapter 4.8 review, but now our test revision stuff. Check off the key concepts. Go over notes from videos. Work through the revision guide, which is already on Canvas. Test yourself on the definitions provided for each video. Complete the topic 4 test yourself, which is in your textbook. And if you have time, rewatch the videos, starting with the topics you had most difficult with from when you checked off the key concepts. And then rinse and repeat. Do it again. Don't stop. We have our tests on the first lesson back in week 6, so make sure you're working through this steadily.